All right. I think I'll get started, yes. Try not to distract me too much, because I'm already distracting today. But so what I would like to talk about is, you know, Foucault categories of Landau-Ginzburg models, or, you know, well, maybe the most common Lefschetz vibrations, but there's basically a question about certain non-compact Lagrangian submanifolds and how we deal with them. Okay, and the first thing to say is, you know, we ask, you know, where's the big conceptual problem? There is actually no big conceptual problem at all. Okay, so this can be done in many different ways. All ways work. Okay, but since this is sort of, you know, a basic ingredient in many things that we do, you know, if you make your life very complicated with the basics, then, you know, those complications will, you know, be carried along and result in, you know, 150-page manuscripts, which then never see the light of day. So that's the only, it's a sort of practical issue, okay? So let's see what's... what is our issue, right? Sometimes people call those Landau-Ginzburg models. And as a familiar special case, we could look at Lefschetz vibrations. Okay, so what we have is that, you know, we have some kind of symplectic manifold. And let's say I have a map, pi goes to C, okay, and, well, which is a and so it may be, you know, the interest comes from some singularities or something that it has, but at infinity things are nice, so is locally trivial symplectic vibration. So, so it's not just that, you know, the fibers are symplectic manifolds outside a compact set, but, you know, the nearby fibers are the same. Of course, that means you can still have some kind of monodromy when you go around a large circle, but that's pretty much it. Okay? I will not to give full detail, so you can ask, well, does it matter to me if the fibers are compact or not? Well, that's you have to take care of that, okay? So, and the things that we look is, so we look at non-compact Lagrangian submanifolds. Which outside a compact subset of C fiber over a half line. I have to choose some direction. Let's say half line is, you know, the real part is constant. And which constant it is, that can depend on your, which, you know, different Lagrangian. And the imaginary part is, okay, this is in C. Okay? So then that means there is some Lagrangian submanifold in the fiber, and you sort of carry it to minus infinity by parallel transport. Okay? So this is the, so Lefschetz thimbles would be an example of this. Okay, so you have the base here, C, and, you know, well, there's some singularity, so nobody knows what's actually going on here in the interior. And your Lagrangian submanifold, also nobody knows what it's doing here, but then eventually it goes to infinity like this. Okay? And so the question is, when you look at two of those things, you know, if this was a left-shift thimble, it would probably more likely look like this. Okay. So these are Lagrangian submanifolds L in E. Okay, and so we could call this thing here L0 and this thing here L1. Okay, and so obviously, you know, if you look down here, each of them is some Lagrangian submanifold in the fiber, and those two Lagrangian submanifolds in the fiber will intersect. So those are sort of intersection points at infinity of these non-compact submanifolds, and the question is, you know, how should we treat them? Should we include them, exclude them? What should we do? Okay. So the convention for intersections at infinity of a pair L is to move L0 to the right. Okay, so we have this situation here, but I leave L1 where it is. This is L1, and now okay. And so we want to measure actually these intersections here. Okay. Is obviously unsymmetric. You know, if I had said the intersection, you know, I want to look at L1 comma L0, I would have moved L1 to the right, and then this point here would actually not be there. Okay. So it's a question here: why move it to the right? Why not move it to the left? Everybody knows why not moving it to the left. Well, the issue is when I look at the a Lagrangian submanifold intersecting with itself. Okay, when I move it to there's supposed to be an intersection point, which is sort of the identity morphism, a distinguished one. And if you move it to the left, that one has the wrong properties. So you really want to you want to move it to the right in this case here. Okay, so what does it actually mean, move it to the right? Okay, so the way that these you know, you have two such manifolds, and you define a flow cohomology group. And so I could say like this, L0, L1, and put in a perturbation, and the perturbation is what's going to move it, right? So this one here is a family of functions on E, okay, and so the way that, you know, what happens is when we try to define this interaction is we look at an equation like this. So this is sort of the holomorphic curve theory, okay, with boundary conditions. There is, you know, this usual, it's some kind of D bar equation. And here, it's, I put in the Hamiltonian vector field. Okay. And so when you look at this, here it has stationary solutions, which are ones that are independent of the R variables. And they just satisfy a dx by dt equals xt. And so these are just, they are lines of this, flow lines of this, well, not flow lines, of this, well, flow lines of this time-dependent Hamiltonian flow that start at L0 and end at L1. And so they correspond bijectively to points of the perturbed intersection where phi t is generated, is the Hamiltonian isotropy that's generated by ht. Okay? And in fact, if you'd like, you can say that this flow cohomology of these guys here with this Hamiltonian perturbation is isomorphic to just the flow cohomology where I actually move this guy here around with the zero Hamiltonian. Okay? So, essentially you change this, you take this equation here, you make ansatz here, you make everything flow along the flow here in t direction, and then in that new ansatz, you will just get a plane holomorphic curve equation without the xt term, but the boundary condition will have changed. Okay, so. Okay, so this is, and so if you want to do this in the specific case here, you just have to choose the flow phi t to move you sufficiently far to the right that you are to the right of L1, and then you're good. Okay, in fact, what you have to choose depends on where L0 and L1 are. Okay? You know, if L0 already lies to the right of L1, you could do nothing. You can just choose a zero Hamiltonian. Okay. Is everybody happy so far? Okay. So the, I'm using wrong kind of joke. So the, the issues here are very simple, and I want to say that let's work in some sort of toy model where the target space is a C standard symplectic form instead of E. So we just work on the base E, and the Lagrangian submanifold are vertical submanifolds. Vertical lines. Well, half. Or, you know. Okay? Because essentially, you know, pretty much everything, you know, if you want, you could choose your, I mean, everything happens down here, right? So if you wanted by a sort of deformation argument, you could choose your fibration to actually, well, you could trivialize your fibration over this part here. And then, you know, everything would just happen in the base direction where you perturb things. Okay? So the issue is the following thing. We are equipped to have this theory to carry a product structure. Suppose I chose some H, and now I want to, you know, so vertical half lines, and so the Hamiltonians will multiples of the imaginary part. Okay, so they're all, I'm just choosing them to be sort of constant translations. Okay? So now, I would like to have a product here. Okay? And there'll be some Hamiltonian here that I chose. Let me not be. And it's supposed to go here. Okay? So these kind of structures are an important part of our theory. So how are these ring structures actually defined? Okay, so you look at some surface, Riemann surface with boundary, S, which looks like this. Okay, and this has this piece, so two pieces here look like this. Okay, and one piece that looks forward, and so this is the TQFT. Okay, so this is S. So let's call this guy here D0S. Let's call this guy D1S. And let's call this guy here D2S. Okay, so actually my usual habit is to write things from right to left as opposed to from left to right, the operations, but I'm trying not to torture you too much. Okay. So we look at this kind of Riemann surface here. Okay. And I'm essentially looking at some kind of equation here. Okay, so for maps, now in my model here, the target space is just the complex plane, and so each boundary component is mapped to its corresponding Lagrangian submanifold, and then you have to write down some sort of inhomogeneous equation. So I have the translational vector field on the complex plane to the right, and it's always going to be okay, let me explain this for a second. So this is the equation, and where which did to the boundary, and which is translation invariant on the ends. Well, which is, okay, let me write down instead of saying it. Let me do a picture here, okay? So let's say over here you want alpha to be some constant, let's say C02 times dt. T is this direction here. Okay, so there's S and T, so T, S. So those are the coordinates here on the ends. And here you want, you don't have to have a constant, you could have a function, but in the end, the only thing that's going to matter is the integral of that function. Okay? And so so now I have to say a bunch of things. Okay, so this guy here is a map from the tangent space of S to the complex numbers. Here you go from the tangent space of S to the reals, and then you just go from the reals to the complex numbers in the obvious way. I mean, dw is just the vector field 1 to the right. Okay, if you want, I could just remove this. Okay, given that the target space is actually the complex plane. Okay, so what happens is that, there's a couple of things to say. So over each end, the reason why we do it like this is, over each end it reduces to a sort of toy model of the previous translation invariant flow equation, where the vector field involved is just, the perturbation involved is just the constant times the translational vector field to the right. Okay, and the other conditions that it be closed and that it vanishes on the boundary have to do with energy. So, we would like the space of all these U to be reasonably well behaved, and in particular, there needs to be so the conditions on alpha. ensure that the energy, which is this gentleman here, is a topological quantity. Which means it's actually given by integrating some closed two form, or, you know, if you like, we could say that you change the, independently of whether U satisfies this equation or not, well, sorry, that's it. As I say, yeah. Okay. So it's given by some kind of integral, and therefore you can get a bound on it just based on the asymptotic behavior of your maps. And so otherwise we have a very hard time controlling the behavior of these maps at all. Okay. Now, the issue with this guy here is the following one, that so necessarily what this means is that since it's by Stokes, that these things here, this is true, right? So so this is a problem, right? So we get, so in particular, L0 equals L1 equals L2, if they were all equal, well, let's say L, okay? And so you have this, let me just put the constant here in. So if you had here, you put in some constant C, and we need C to be greater than zero so that, you know, things will be pushed to the right, and you get this guy here. You end up in this thing with 2C, okay? So this is, well, in fact, it doesn't really matter whether it takes C or 2C on the level of Fleur cohomology. So there's canonical isomorphism. But, you know, we want to often work on a sort of chain complex level. And so these, you know, these cohomology groups may be, may be isomorphic for 2C and C. But the isomorphism isn't straightforward. So, you know, the attempt to build this into the foundations is very nice. We would like this guy here to actually be a ring, okay, and not go into some group which is not quite the thing that we want to go into. Okay, and so so this is the sort of basic problem, okay. Happiness, okay? And as I said, you know, it's a problem of a practical nature. Things have been posed. You know, you could just try to take some direct limit as C goes to infinity, and then in the direct limit it would increase. You could try to use various kinds of rescaling tricks, actually, as proposed in this context here, they should or something. You could sort of, you know, try to sort of ignore the problem and work only with part of it, or you could be actually back, in which case the solution is rather ingenious, but involves a fair amount of work around. Okay, so what is actually the basic problem? Okay, basic problem is that so let's see, so these guys here, so they, we have these guys here, okay, they go to infinity like this. Okay. And the behavior at infinity is given by essentially, you know, these two points here. Okay? And the thing that we have allowed ourselves is to translate, right? So translation not act transitively on pairs of points. I hope you agree on that, right? And that's why it matters whether there is the what the distance is between those two. Okay. What is the most stupid thing that we could do to make the distance here become irrelevant? Okay. So I hope you all agree that if affine transformations of the real line act transitively on odd pairs of points, in fact that they act simply transitively. It's nice, right? Okay, so let's so we'll go to a larger thing and allow ourselves affine transformations. Okay. So transformations. Okay. Okay, and I. Okay, so the we have the group G transformation of the real line. There are translations, and there are well, it's oriented affine transformations, and there are dilations. So this is acting on R. Okay. Now the only difference with respect to the previous thing. You know, the previous group that we used was essentially the group of translations, which is abelian. So I could just say we translate by this and this amount. This is not an abelian group, okay? So so the data okay, so before that I said, you know, we have essentially I'm going to have these 2 points. And there'll be, you know, the distance between them. So what we do is now over the ends. So I want to look at the following thing here. So I want to look at a triple here. Okay. So lambda zero, lambda one in R is essentially like the position of our Lagrangian submanifolds, and A is also. I need this guy. It's the Lie algebra. So, and A is now going to be this sort of kind of flow, but I would like it, you know, to formulate it as a one form with values in this Lie algebra. Okay. Okay. So then, so D mod gives a GF connection. On 0, 1, hence a so I you know I integrate this thing here. Map. Let's call it G in G. And now we ask that G of lambda 0 is bigger than lambda 1. So that's going to be a new thing. Instead of moving things to the right by translation, I move them by affine transformations, and then I ask at the endpoint this should be right of that, as before. Okay? So this connection is sort of my time-dependent Hamiltonian, except it's structure group, and we're not Hamiltonians yet. Okay, so let let's call this like this. Be the space of all such triples. Okay. And then, so since I have connections, I should have gauge transformations acting on them. Hope to do this right. Oh, F. Sorry, maybe I shouldn't put superscripts, but you know. Okay, so so this group here acts on it. So meaning what? Well, you think of this thing here as the following data. A gives you a connection on the trivial bundle over the interval, and lambda 0 and lambda 1 sit in the fibers of the endpoint. Okay, so then you act by the gauge transformation, and you act by the values at the endpoint. And so this acts on this space here. Well, how does it act? Well, you have a connection. connection on a on an interval, of course you can trivialize the connection, okay? And that trivialization is so if you trivialize the connection, what you have is you have the trivial connection, and they have these two real numbers, lambda 0 and lambda 1, which now satisfy that lambda 0 is bigger than lambda 1. And you still have freedom, namely, you can apply constant gauge transformation, which is translating and rescaling, and that every pair is as good as every other pair. So acts simply transitively. On PF 01. Okay? So in particular, this guy here is actually contractible. Okay? Because, well, G affine is contractible, and so it's... Okay? Why is it important that things be contractible, right? So, I mean, this is a basic thing. So, you know, when we do these kind of manipulations with operations by Riemann surfaces, you have the Riemann surface, and then you have a bunch of additional data. Okay? And what theory you get depends on what the topological content of those data is. And, you know, the theories that we usually like, you know, algebras and infinity categories and so on, the data is supposed to be contractible. Okay? Okay, this is what I'm going to do over the ends. And now, what I'm going to do over my Riemann surface. Given a Riemann surface of the form, okay, that guy here, this could have more than two inputs, but you know, let me just stick to the inputs. So we fix. I need to fix sort of my toy model for my Lagrangian submanifolds. Actually, you know what? Let me put in sort of a bunch more n's here. Okay. So I fix these guys here, and they are thought of as living over these boundary components here. And this is lambda d, which will be the last. And a naught, a d in omega 1, 0, 1. Okay, and these are thought of as living over here, so there's A0 over here, A1, and so on, up to AD. Okay? Such that the data at each end F01. Okay, what does it mean, the data at each end? Well, sorry, I'm trying not to write too much. So if you look at this end here, you have this A1, and you have lambda 0 and lambda 1, and that triple should line it. If you look at this end here, you have A0, and you have lambda 0, lambda d, and this here. So these are just the data that I want to put over the ends, and now I consider there's the data here on S. Okay, and what I want to choose is the inhomogeneous term and the boundary condition. Okay, so it's a pair A comma lambda. So this guy here is a one form on my surface with values in this Lie algebra. What I'm actually going to do, because it's nice and gauge invariant, is I'm going to allow my Lagrangian submanifolds to sort of move as I go along the boundary. So this is a function, okay, of the boundary going to R, okay, such that A is flat. Well, I always, you know, if I have a one form, I think connection D minus A is flat. D minus dA plus a half A bracket A is equal. Okay? And that replaces my previous condition that I choose a one form which is closed. You know, before that, I had an abelian Lie algebra, so I just the condition of flatness, just condition of closeness of the one form. I actually have flatness. The second condition, now the other thing that I had before is I said if you had a one form and some condition you restrict it to the boundary, it vanishes. Okay, that had to do with the interaction between the one form and the boundary condition. Now here is the condition. Slightly different is if you have a path that lies in the boundary, it should essentially preserve this lambda here. Okay, so you just move. So you have a path in the boundary. You parallel transport for this connection. That's an element of it's an affine transport, and then whatever you put at the starting point to whatever you put at the end point. Okay. And okay. So and then now I have to match it up with the asymptotic conditions. Okay, and what do I do? That, so on the jth end, j equals 1 to d, which is minus infinity 0 cross 0, 1. What you have is that a is the previous thing that I chose, so ai. Which means it's only exists in it only points in this dt direction, and lambda of this point s comma zero is equal this lambda j minus one lambda s comma one is equal lambda j, and on the only end that looks like this, the output end a is equals a naught and lambda. Lambda naught, lambda s1 is lambda 1. Okay, so basically lambda d. So essentially, I just want the data to match up with the stuff that I gave you for the prescribed behavior. Okay? And p of s, p affine of s, I guess. What did I call the prescribed? P affine, yeah, of s, be the space of all such. A lambda, where the data on the ends are fixed. Oh, sorry. Data on the ends are fixed. Okay? Actually, let me put in the notation. I want to say relative to the ends so that I remember that the data on the ends are fixed. Okay? So, all right. Okay, and so then the key thing here is that there's no topology in these choices. Okay? It's contractible. Don't actually, you know, whatever choices you make, you know, they're sort of homotopically unique, and that will be crucial for all your purposes, in particular when you're trying to make those choices over a family of varying Riemann surfaces. Okay? And I think that, you know, since this was rather confusing definition, I should give the proof, which is extremely easy. Okay? Okay. So, leave the. Suppose that I did the same thing and I said, okay, the ends here, everything should be, you know, translation invariant, but I don't prescribe what this is. Okay? So then you would get, so this yields a bigger space. Let's call this guy here P affine of S. So what happens is that, you know, you can evaluate what happens on each end. On each end, you get one of those previous things. One ends, and if you do this in a specific way, we get what I did before. Okay, this is a fibration, and so this guy here, I already explained that they're contractible, and so this guy here is a homotopy equivalence. Okay, so I can look at this larger space instead. By the way, if you're thinking of giving me a hard time about, you know, what the topology on these spaces are, I will immediately retreat to the notion of weak homotopy equivalence. I mean, really, all you need is, you know, finite dimensional families of elements of these spaces. You know, it's not. So, okay. And if you think about it, this sort of all looks rather silly. Because I'm talking about flat connections on a surface which is simply connected, right? And so so any flat connection on S can be trivialized. Okay. So what does this mean by a gauge transformation? So phi goes to SG, which is translation invariant on the ends. So GF of S be those phi, which are translation invariant on each end. That doesn't really matter. Invariant on each end. On each end. Okay, and by the way, I forgot the superscript again. Okay, so then what I have here is I've wrote space here, but you can trivialize any of those, okay? And what happens if you had the trivial connection? Well, if I have the trivial connection, what I have left are those bounders that function on the boundary. Now, since there's a condition of parallel transport, that function on the boundary is actually locally constant. So which means you just have a set of numbers, one for each boundary component, and there's some condition they have to be ordered in a specific way. Okay, so, yes. Well, you know, it means that, you know, when you look at each, it has to lie here, and there was a question in the definition here which said if you parallel transport from 0 to 1, you have to, one endpoint has to end up at the right of the other. Okay? So that condition based on each end here.
So we are restricting the ends, possible ends.
Yeah.
I just don't see that ordering in the previous.
Well, here is because I restricted the behavior on each end, and at some point I've written that the data associated to the ends that has to lie in P01. But I erased it already. Okay? So it was part of our condition here. So you can choose these guys here. You can trivialize any connection. Left is you are left with a bunch of numbers. And those satisfy this condition here. Okay. And that trivialization is unique up to constant gauge transformations. Okay. And now everything in here actually contractible. This is clearly a contractible space. This is contractible. That's contractible. So the maps into a contractible group, and so everything is contractible. Okay. Okay. So now we deal with one thing that so far, you know, the symplectic geometry of everything sort of disappeared, right? And I, you know, you will have noticed that. Well, translations, you know, we have a Lefschetz vibration, let's consider just the base, C, and translations act by symplectomorphisms, by area-preserving maps. But the dilations, the affine transformations, do not act by area-preserving maps. Well, True. Okay. So. So what do we actually do, right? Well, it's a matter of point of view, right? So you know, when I said the base of the Lefschetz vibration is the complex plane, right? I'm making a, you know, what it is really, it's a supposed to be symplectic R2, right? When I said it's the complex plane, I made a choice of complex structure, right? And there was no reason why I should have chosen that particular complex structure. So okay, so Lefschetz vibration to be the upper half plane. And a nice compactification. Okay, union infinity. Okay. And this thing here is the circle at infinity in hyperbolic. Okay. And I equip this guy here with the with the hyperbolic metric. Okay, so omega h is d real part, d imaginary part, divided by the imaginary part. What is it, squared? Yes? Okay. And so, by the way, this even has a distinguished primitive. And so GF acts by hyperbolic isomorphism. In fact, one preserve theta as well, if you care. Okay. Just the usual action on the real line by affine transformation to a holomorphic action on H, and it actually to that continuously extends to H bar, and that preserves our symplectic form. Okay, and that includes translations and dilations, which is what we needed. I want to say a couple more things about this. Actually, exactly one more thing. Okay, so. So correspondingly, the Lie algebra G maps to Hamiltonian vector fields, and that map can be lifted to Hamiltonian functions. What does it mean uniquely? Yeah. Sure, you can take a Hamiltonian function, you can add a constant. Now, if you want it to be a map of Lie algebras to be compatible with the Poisson bracket, there's exactly one way to do it. Okay? Okay. So
this is also true, right? All hyperbolic isometries that.
Yes, that's absolutely true. But you know, basically what I needed is translations and dilations. And this is the smallest I can get away with it. Okay? So maybe you didn't like what I did, you want arbitrary diffeomorphisms of the real line, and you're welcome, then you have to find a larger group of symplectic automorphisms of after all, what is the disk that extend those. Okay? But this is the cheapest thing, and it's very cheap because all of them are also holomorphic, so they also preserve the complex structure. So I never have to actually change the standard hyperbolic complex structure. Okay, so So what are we going to do with these things here? Okay. So now I'm going to. So I had two things that I've explained, which is this is quasi-physical terminology, right? In these kinds of theories, there is the world sheet, which is the Riemann surface you're mapping from, and there is the target space. Okay. So I explained what to do on the world sheet. It was a bit complicated. You have flat connections and so on and so on. Now I explained what our toy model is of the target space. Okay. Should I say that? Okay. So our Lagrangian submanifolds will still be vertical lines. So actually, theta h vanishes on each of them. Okay. But what you should think about is, I'm thinking about the upper half plane as a model, and so the vertical line, of course, goes to infinity and goes down to here. But really, the thing that's interesting is where it goes down to here. This is my model for my Lefschetz vibration near infinity. So the other part, I'm not so interested in. These are going to be my models. So now I'm going to put the two things together and give you a theory of holomorphic maps into this toy model target space. Okay. So take S to be an arbitrary Riemann surface with boundary, okay, and suppose that we have the following thing. So the same data as before, and lambda such that A is flat and lambda is compatible transport. Okay, now I'm not going to worry about saying okay there are n's, what is, because I'm just trying to write down the sort of differential equations that we would look at in this case, and mostly be interested in the local behavior. Okay, so then I consider the following thing here. I consider maps into the complex plane, and the boundary conditions are given by lambda in the sense, also into the upper half plane, okay? And the boundary conditions are given by by lambda. So if you are in the boundary, you want to lie on the corresponding vertical half line. So the real part of this here is given by lambda at the point z. And there is going to be a condition here. Okay. Okay. Where x sub a is the one form in Hamiltonian, in vector fields, let's say, associated to A. Okay? So which, A is a one form with values in this Lie algebra. Algebra maps to vector fields by this infinitesimal action, and so you have a one form that's fields. This is the 0-1 part with respect to the natural complex structures on the domain and range. Okay? So this is going to be the model for our equation. And now I'm going to go through the things that people usually worry about.
Yes.
Oh, they can change. They, you know, in this quantity, I don't have. Well, it depends on what your connection is, right? Everything is. So the. Okay. Right. Let's talk a little bit about things. Okay. So. So maybe the most important thing that I can say here is gauge invariance. Okay. So. Okay. So, oops. By the way, I forgot the superscript again. Okay. So, gauge invariance. What if you take those transformation here, phi, that brings your connection to another connection. It brings your boundary condition to another boundary condition. And if you apply the action of those gauge transformations to you, you get a solution of the gauge transform connection. So, in particular. So, if your surface is simply connected, or in any way local considerations reduced to A equals zero, lambda equals constant. Okay? So A equals zero, lambda equals constant just means that U is just a holomorphic function, and the real part of U to the boundary is constant. Okay? So it's a holomorphic function with boundary conditions on a single vertical line, and any undergraduate can deal with it. I think they really can. Okay? So after having said that, pretty much anything you can say after that is sort of anticlimactic, right? So I should say that there is a a topological notion, topological invariant notion of energy. Energy, okay, which is this guy here. So the energy of a solution is, as usual, would be the integral of this guy here, which is the following thing when you, after you think about it for a while, it's a the pullback of the volume form on the hyperbolic plane minus d of okay. More or less, where h a is a one form on s with values in C infinity HR. Okay. So as usual, we have this, we have A, which gives one form valued in the Lie algebra, and to each element of the Lie algebra associated with a Hamiltonian function. And that is a that is this term here that you get. So you use this to make a one form on the surface, and then you differentiate that guy here. Okay. Right, so essentially, this is topological in the sense that, you can apply Stokes to it, right? So if you apply Stokes to this term here, you're supposed to get the integral of theta h, which is the primitive of the boundary. But due to the boundary conditions, the primitive actually, this will contribute essentially nothing. Let's say this. If I had to make an argument for why this is well-behaved, I'd reduce to this case here, okay? Then this term here would disappear. The boundary conditions would be constant, and theta would really vanish on the boundary conditions. And if that's not the case, there are various terms, but they all cancel out because of gauge invariance. Okay? So control of energy is one thing that people worry about in this kind of context, and control of energy works very well. The other thing that people worry about is, what happens if I have, so these are maps into this upper half plane. The upper half plane is compact. What happens if, I have control, I have a sequence, they say they have bounded energy, but somehow they diverge, so they converge to infinity in the upper half plane, right? And so they usually what people do is that they consider some sort of maximum principle. Maximum principles are really a bad idea throughout, because what a maximum principle means is that you draw some line and you say it will never cross this line, okay? But really, well, first of all, this would be impossible for me because there's no line I can draw that's actually invariant under affine transformation of the. So, and also, you know, I don't really care whether it stays, you know, to draw the line somewhere as long as it doesn't actually go to infinity. Okay? So let's look at it. So, in fact, this situation here is so benign that you can actually get bounds even without assuming bounds on the energy. Okay, I just have to look at the constants here. Ay, ay, ay. Ah, there we are. Okay. All right, so. Up. Wrong shock. Lemma. Okay. So, one. Suppose I should call this God. Did I just raise it? Oh, yeah. This equation here. Let me call it star. Okay. Okay. Suppose. Suppose S is a Riemann surface. I'm working locally. So let's suppose that this is, I look at the solution that's defined on a disk of radius r in C, right? So then, so looking locally on the domain, then for any solution U of star, so this quantity here, okay, the thing that you're interested, okay, at this point, okay, is, so this is with respect to the hyperbolic metric, okay. Okay, so there's a sort of, they bound their own energy, okay. So the bound, this is the thing that you're trying to, this is the guy that appears in here, okay. So there's an intrinsic bound on the energy, on the kind of size of the derivative. If you said A equals zero locally, this is really, and to the same holds. So one thing that you'll notice if you're sort of minded for this kind of stuff is that that bound, let's say we just look at the center of the disk, right, zero. So there's a bound that says it's less than two, okay. Oops, sorry, there should be, oh, I didn't do it right. The radius should be somewhere in here. What am I doing? The radius gets smaller, the bound should be worse. I think I lost the radius somewhere here. There you go. Sorry about that. Okay? Okay, so you'll notice that the bound gets worse as your radius gets smaller. You know, if you try to draw a disk around, you know, as you approach the boundary of your Riemann surface, things seem to get worse. But in fact, the same holds for S equals dr plus, which in which case when you're near a boundary point, which is z in r, and say the real part of z greater equal to zero in c, okay, you get the exact same bound. Okay, so it's kind of self-bounded. And well, what are these? Where do these lemmas come from? Well, it's easy. You do a transformation to a equals zero, and then it's actually the Schwarz lemma in complex analysis. Well, that's the part. One is the Schwarz lemma. Part two, you have a half disk. Well, you use the sort of reflection principle to make a disk out of it, and then you apply the Schwarz lemma. So the things bound themselves. And so what happens to your original, to this problem? We have a sequence of solutions which try to escape, right? That doesn't really answer my question, right? So, okay, supposition. So fix A and lambda. Okay, suppose that there is a sequence UK of solutions of star and points ZK in S contained in a compact subset. Subset such that the UK of ZK goes to my boundary. Okay? So this just means basically, you know, it goes out to infinity. Okay? So then UK converges uniform. There's another thing, you know, usually when you take the base of things to be the complex plane, when things go out to infinity, you know, you get very scared because the only compactification of the complex plane is CP1, but the data that you choose do not extend over CP1, right? So everything will become divergent. However, the hyperbolic disk, which we're working with here, the guise of the upper half plane, has this nice compactification, H bar, which acts as circle at infinity, and the action, the Hamiltonian vector fields extend smoothly to the compactification. Okay? It converges uniformly compact subsets to extra space. To some map, U infinity goes to actually the boundary. And so there's boundary conditions here, and this guy here is, well, you know, you had this half line, right? So it's either the, you know, you had this half line here, real part of W is some number lambda, and there's the actual point lambda in R, and there's the other end, which is infinity. And is this guy here, lambda or infinity, lambda z or infinity. And it satisfies, well, does it mean it's the same condition? It actually satisfies not the Debye condition, but the actual equal to zero. Okay? So this guy here is not a condition on partial derivative, it completely governs the derivative. And you know, most of the time, when you look in any application you're interested in, you look at this guy here, and this has no solutions whatsoever. Okay? So for instance, you know, when we looked at this case of Riemann surfaces with ends, it's pretty clear when you look at the end that there is no solution here, because that would correspond to your two Lagrangians actually meeting at infinity, but you know, after applying the perturbation, they never do. Okay? Okay, so what's the proof of this guy here? So this gives you a very good control on things going to infinity. So, proof, okay, sorry, then, oh my god, a subsequence of. Okay, proof. Okay. All right, so let me say things like this. Okay, so, so I know that I have a bound on the derivatives here from the previous lemma. That bound is with respect to the hyperbolic metric on the target space. Okay, but I want to point out to you that the hyperbolic metric blows up as you reach the boundary. So if I was interested in a bound with respect to, say, you know, some metric that extends over H bar, that would be even better. Okay. So we have, a priori, C1 bounds. And in fact, well, locally, and in fact, C infinity, well, where is it? C0 local bounds on derivatives. On derivatives. Okay. So a limit exists, and that limit will be of a subsequence, a priori that will be something that maps to H bar. It satisfies, remember this equation that I've wrote down, so it has u z, okay, so real part of u0 of z is lambda z, or there's the point at infinity, u z infinity of z equals infinity, so it's a closure of that line for z in the boundary. And this equation here that I've wrote down, it makes perfect sense for maps that are valued in H bar. Okay? So well, I have C zero bound on derivatives, right? But in fact, you know, elliptic bootstrap, I have a CK bound on derivatives. Well, remember, I can gauge transform locally into the theory of standard holomorphic functions, right? So when I say you have elliptic bootstrap, that just means, you know, you apply a Cauchy integral formula. So I have some limit here, okay? And moreover, there is some point, a point, z infinity, such that u of z infinity is on the boundary. Okay? All right. Happiness? Okay, because I take for a subsequence, there was a sequence of points contained in a compact subset, such that this goes to infinity, and so in the limit, I get some point. Okay? Okay, so now let's talk a little bit. So I look at this point. Let me gauge transform to ordinary holomorphic functions. Okay? Yes?
So one minus
why is it always, oh, gosh, it's r squared minus. You're completely right. That's where it was. Oh, I was missing something. There you go. The hyperbolic match norm with respect. No, it's pointwise. This is an inequality that holds at a point, right? It's with respect to the standard metric on the disk and the hyperbolic metric on the target space, and it holds everywhere. Thank you, Melissa. I didn't pay attention in my complex analysis class. There you go. Now I'm penance. Okay, I think we're good. Okay? So now let's talk a little bit about this candidate here. Okay? So what you have is you have a holomorphic map that takes, so I have to gauge transform it locally into actual holomorphic map. You have a holomorphic map that takes values anywhere in the upper half plane, and at some point it lies in the boundary of the upper half plane. But clearly it's locally constant near that point. Right? When you take and you transform it back, you find that it's the solution of this guy here. Okay? And then obviously being the same thing holds at the boundary, you think a little bit with the boundary condition. And then they each transformed holomorphic functions. If they're locally constant somewhere, they're constant everywhere. So a unique continuation applies. Okay? So after you get to this, it turns out that you know the only this thing here has to actually vanish, not just its 0-1 part, and it has to lie everywhere in the boundary. Okay? So you have an extremely good control over these things. Now, the last thing I'm going to say, which I'm not going to write down because I'm too lazy. Okay? So the only objection you might have is that I said points contained in a compact subset. Right? So you know what happens, for instance, my original surface has like ends, and the points where things diverge lie, you know, further and further down the end, for instance, and usually you apply some kind of rescaling trick. That's actually not necessary. If you look at the equation that you usually get on these kind of strips, that's sort of a translation invariant equation. Actually, hyperbolic geometry gives you an upper bound on the length of the strip. Okay, so you can't actually have these very long strips at all. So, what happens? How do we apply this to Lefschetz vibrations? Right. So you have your its vibration, its basis, the upper half plane, and outside a compact subset, it is a locally trivial symplectic vibration. So you take this action, these vector fields on the base, and you cut them off by zero on the interior, and then you can lift them. So at infinity, they can lift. Of course, this is not a map of Lie algebras, okay? And it's also, you know, there's no, you know, the group of affine transformation acts on the base, but that does not actually lift to an action on the total space of the Lefschetz vibration. So when you apply to that vibration, you will lose this gauge group. Okay? Arguments that I made by saying transform to gauge equals is why, you know, you might be wondering, why don't I just say A equals 0 through A? No longer have gauge invariance. But what you do is, well, I mean, you know, it doesn't, not all of it works up, but essentially, as far as properties are concerned of your map near infinity, which is what you're concerned with, you project to the base, and you always arrange that projection is holomorphic. Everything is invariant, and so you control things over the base, right? Obviously, you know, the Schwarz lemma doesn't applies only to where projection to the base is actually holomorphic. You have to work a little bit harder. But still, it's true that just like the disk had a compactification, you just compactify the Lefschetz fibration to a complex manifold that sits over the closed disk. And then, you know, the worst thing you use, if you really want to, is just Gromov compactness over this thing here, which is a manifold with boundary fitting over the complex disk. And so I explained how we can choose this kind of stuff that we need over every Riemann surface, you know, at least the ones that we need to make this categorical structure, products, and so on. So you choose these flat connections on each of them, depending smoothly, and so on, and you make the modular spaces. Thank you very much.